In this video, I'm going to be talking about the greenskins, and we're going to take a look at the greenskins. I also want to make this video a bit differently from what I've done in the past, where I've let sort of battle videos speak for themselves, and then I've made a completely separate faction video. In this case, I'm going to show the faction in battle just after I've finished talking about the faction. So, the greenskins. For those of you who are unfamiliar with the world of Warhammer, greenskins are archetypical orcs. They're ranging from big nasty black orcs down to your standard orc boys, and then there's a strict hierarchy from the biggest orcs and down to the goblins, and at the very bottom of the pile the snotlings, but they haven't made it into the game, unfortunately, have to say. Won't go too much into the background of the orcs, because that's far outside of the scope of this video. They can be led by a goblin great shaman, being a spellcaster. He can draw magic, these are his spells, and I'll talk about the spells as well, because why not? Sneaky stealing is going to steal away the ability for the enemy wizards to cast magic, which can be useful against certain factions. Against something like dwarves, utterly useless. Sneaky stabbing, increasing armor piercing and melee attack, pretty long range on these spells, and for 12 seconds as well. Reducing the ability of the enemy, reducing the speed of the enemy, reducing the shootiness of the enemy. And what you'll find is that there are these magical missiles. There's another Gaze of Nagash, and I'm sure there are some others as well. They are actually missiles, so you need to be careful about where you're firing from, because you could risk just throwing it through your own units. Curse of the Bad Moon, significant reduction in the combatability of the enemy with this one. I have to be honest, when playing orcs and goblins, I prefer not to bring this guy. The Goblin Great Shaman is very inexpensive. However, this is where it starts getting fun. The Orc Warboss, Azag the Slaughterer, Grimgor Ironheart. Orc Warboss being the standard vanilla Orc Warboss. His stats are decent. He doesn't rank exceptionally high on any stats. His weapon strength is quite good. The weapon damage of all of the hero type characters is quite insane, but nothing really stands out with this guy. He has the Stand Your Ground, Foe Seeker, and the War ability, increasing melee attack of all things, not just not charge bonus, which it really should have increased. Then for only 200 more, you get Azag the Slaughterer, and I have to say, I don't see any reason whatsoever to bring the Orc Warboss over Azag the Slaughterer if you intend to use the magic. If you intend to use magic at all. Magic can be annoying, but if you want to have some magic, there are some great spells here. Life Leech. Let's see. Purple Son of Serus. Doom and Darkness, Soul Blight, Spirit Leech, which will sap the life out of enemy monsters, single characters, extremely quickly. So if you want to go a more magic heavy route, I think going with the more heavily armored and combat able Azag the Slaughterer is a good idea. And you can of course make him flying. The Goblin can be put on a Giant Wolf, which is fast enough, speed of 94. But he can't fly. So Azag the Slaughterer on Skullmuncha is a very dangerous foe indeed. And then we have Grimgor Ironhide. Grimgor Ironhide is immune to psychology, him being a black orc and all. With this guy, you're getting a lot of armor. The weapon damage is quite decent. Decent charge bonus, but once again, no magic, and he can't have any mounts, which Grimgor is very easy to stun. He can very easily be stunned by monsters, he can very easily be stunned by flyers. So Grimgor is a bit of a risk, Azog the Slaughterer is a very, very safe pick because you can get Azog where you need him to be, whereas Grimgore is much slower being on foot. Then we have Goblin Big Boss, Knight Goblin Shaman. Same spells here, and the Orc Shaman. With the Orc Shaman, you get things like the Foot of Gork, Edbut, that can do damage to single enemy targets. Brain Burst that damage to single enemy targets. So here we go, plus 58 melee attack, quite a lot there. Fist of Gork, plus 22% missile damage, Fists of Gork. These types of spells are great for increasing the combat ability of your hard hitters down here. However, the question is whether he can contribute more to the battle than just an additional unit. And I find that not to be the case. If you're the Greenskins, ideally you want to swarm the enemy. Because that's what you're good at. You're good at numbers and you're good at swarming the enemy. Getting to infantry here, we have the Goblins. And Goblins, just shitty stats all over. What you'll note, which is very important, even though these are spear infantry, they do not have a bonus versus large. So the Knight Goblins come at... what's really weird about this, I'm fairly certain it should be the other way around. The Knight Goblins having higher leadership than the standard Goblins. Knight Goblins with Fanatics, Orc Boys, Savage Orcs, Orc Biggins, Savage Orc Biggins, and the biggest and the baddest, the Black Orcs. I've found good use for the Orc Boys, being shielded, having some armor. Not the worst leadership, not the highest. Savage Orcs can be very powerful. However, there's a big however with the Savage Orcs. Lacking any kind of armor and any kind of shield, they are incredibly, incredibly fragile. Then the Orc Biggins. Decent enough. They have a bonus versus large for whichever reason. They have a bit of armor. Their leadership isn't great. And you're not really getting that much. That much more combat ability out of them compared to the lineup of boys. The bonus, the weapon strength is substantially higher, and I do like the unit, but I'm kind of on... Oh, sorry. I see I go back there. I'm kind of on the fence about the Biggins. I tend to bring them, but they do not perform as well as I'd like them to. Savage Orc Biggins, bigger Savage Orcs, and then we have the Black Orcs. A hefty price for the Black Orcs. The weapon strength is high. They don't have a bonus versus anything, but very high armor piercing, very high armor. Their leadership is good. They are immune to psychology, which can be extremely useful in an Orc and Goblin army. However, they really should have had some type of inspire effect on the rest of the units here. Nice selection of missile infantry. I don't find poison to be worth it. Poisoned attacks from the Knight Goblins. Reducing speed, weapon damage, armor piercing, missile damage, and vigor, so stamina, by quite a bit. So one or two can be very nice, but the poison only lasts for 5 seconds, which means that you need to continually apply it. And of course, with the orcs, you're going to want to get into melee as quickly as possible, and that severely limits the amount of volleys you're going to be able to lay down. Orc Arrow Boys, Orc Archers, longer range, 135, 110 here for the Goblins. The Knight Goblin Archers with Fanatics cost slightly more because of the Fanatics. The Savage Orc Arrow Boys, 135 range, poor accuracy. I haven't played a lot with these different Arch units. Once again, you kind of have to overwhelm your opponent. With the Goblin Wolf Riders, things start to become interesting. This unit costs 300, is extremely fragile, doesn't have very high leadership, it's very quick, it has Vanguard deployment. So with these guys, you can deploy them outside of your deployment zone and spring some nasty traps. Same with the Forest Goblin Spider Riders. It's a Strider, So no terrain penalties for this unit. However, if you're attacking a unit uphill, the unit attacking you downhill is still going to get its bonuses. You're just not going to be penalized for attacking that way. So poison lasts for 5 seconds, makes more sense in melee, but they don't have that much damage. Orc boar boys, decent enough cavalry unit. They are anti-infantry, same with the savage orc boar boys, quite good at attacking and killing infantry. Frenzy, making them immune to psychology, physical resistance of 20%. So they don't have much armor, but they do have a resistance to some of the damage they're taking. Boar boys, biggins, I mean, you'll see this pattern with the orcs. Things just get slightly bigger and slightly orcier with each iteration. The orc boar boy biggins actually do have a bonus versus large of 12. Still, they are no demigryphs, make no mistake about that, but they can do a decent enough job against some enemy cavalry units. The orc boar chariot also has a bonus here versus infantry, and the boar chariot can be nice, but it does require a lot of micro to work properly, and you can afford it with the orc horde because it's mostly sending in units to tie down stuff and then having a few key units to destroy enemy units with. So the boar chariot can be made to work, but I don't particularly like it. And the savage orc boar biggins, no bonuses versus anything. 20% physical resistance. I don't find these guys to be worth it. For the missile cav, goblin wolf rider archers can be nice, but the range is short. It has fire whilst moving. But I don't know whether it has Parthian. Let's see. Not really sure. Same here with the forest goblin spider riders and the goblin wolf chariot. Anti-infantry bonus on that as well. Quite high missile damage there on the goblin wolf chariot. For the monsters, the troll can be nice. Very low leadership. Keep them close to your general, buff them, and they will do a decent enough job. 90 weapon strength, 9 trolls in the unit. They do regenerate, so if they pull out of combat, they'll go back in quite a lot of the time if they aren't killed. The giant, don't find the giant to be worth it. He dies way too easily. The Arachnarok, you've seen me test the Arachnarok a lot, and in a one versus one scenario, the Arachnarok is a beast. But the Arachnarok on the battlefield doesn't perform. It will get focused on. It will allow some of your boys to get closer to the enemy. But you're almost getting 5 units of orc boys for the price of 1 Arachnarok. So I don't really find the Arachnarok to be worth it. The Goblin Rock Lobber, standard artillery. Doom Diver Catapult, not so standard. Kamikaze Suicide Goblins with a spiky helmet hurtling towards the enemy. So, I could, of course, do what I've done previously and show you how these units look on the battlefield. Just fill an entire roster of them and go and have a look. I'm sure you've seen all of the cool units before, so I'm not going to do that. Instead, I am going to go and show you a battle here. Just a friendly battle. Between me and Obelix. And I hope the title didn't give it away. because that could be interpreted either way. So you can see the armies here. These are not competitive armies, or at least I don't think Obelix's idea was to be as competitive as possible, and mine wasn't either. I think this was my second Orc and Goblin game. I've uploaded one of them before on the channel. So what I went for here, I went for a solid line of 6 boys in the center, 6 Orc boys. I kept my black orcs, my hitting power here on the flanks, fairly concentrated. I figured there was going to be a lot of fire coming down the center, so I wanted to keep my black orcs relatively safe on the flanks. I have a doom diver here, you'll see why in a second. 2 units of trolls, 1 unit of orc boar boy biggins, just to mop up any artillery if there was any. There wasn't. Here we have Asag the Slaughterer, very useful against the dwarves. And I've snuck some goblin wolf riders into the back. Now for Obelix here, he has dwarf warriors with great weapons. He has a huge line here of, 4 longbeards, 4 dwarf warriors, 3 quarrelers, 4 miners with blasting charges, and 2 gyrocopters, his heroes and lords, the master engineer, a ranged hero, and then the slayer king. So there's a lot of infantry here. I am most certainly outmatched in terms of infantry. No question about it. And most of these, or many of these units, will have charge deflection. And here goes the first Doom Diver. I wanted to see whether I could hit the gyrocopter. No, I couldn't. I swing and a miss. So I figured, okay, let's just let the goblin archers ward off the gyrocopters. Because I'm not hitting anything with these poor goblins. So I figured, okay, let's try to snipe some... Oh, shit. See if they can... Ooh, dodged it. Just dodged the goblin there. And the goblin goes flying straight into the wall. So I'm starting to chase these gyrocopters here with my... with Asag. I need to be a bit careful. But wanted to get some magic in. Fate of Buna. Dwarves do have magical resistance though. But they don't have resistance to wyverns tearing apart their gyrocopters. Gyrocopters are very fragile, but I decided to pull out of there because the quarrelers are firing. So I wanted to get the goblin wolf riders into the flank of the miners here with the blasting charges. And these are just suicidal tactics. Hitting the dwarves on the move, I really should have turned back and got another charge into the back of these miners here. But I'm trying to get into the quarrelers. And this is basically just buying myself the time for Asag here to regenerate some spells so I can cast some more magic. And these wolf riders are a sacrificial unit anyway. They didn't manage to get much killing done here. What am I casting here? Fate of Buna again against several of these units. And you can see it's sapping the health and the manpower or the dwarf power out of these units. The dwarves are also blowing up their own dwarves here. But I do need to be careful because I am taking crossbow fire on Asag. But it wasn't too bad. There were some dwarven casualties in here as well. And look at what's happening with the Doom Divers. The Doom Divers are crashing in with their long range into the Master Engineer. Let's see, there's another Doom Diver. Boom! So the Master Engineer isn't doing too well at the moment. He's being set up for a Spirit Leech at some point. Let's see how much damage he's taking from a direct hit here. That's a miss, I think. I think that was a miss. But I am flying around. Yeah, there it is. There is the Spirit Leech. And there's a flying goblin, so not a good day to be a Master Engineer. And Obelix doesn't like getting his character sniped here, so he's moving up. Which is... nice for me. Here are the boys ready for a good scrap. Here they go. Here we go. Going in for the charge. The blasting charges are hitting my orcs. So, yeah. Hitting both orc and dwarf are these charges. Over on the flanks here, sending in my orc boys. These sneaky gyrocopters are shooting at my black orcs. So I've actually lost some very unnecessary hit points on the black orcs. Sneaky. But the goblin archers are warding off those guys. And you can see I lost relatively quickly here against the dwarf warriors. No small part due to the blasting charges. So time to send in the trolls to see if they can do any damage. And the doom divers are still doing damage to the master engineer over here. So the trolls are going in trying to break the dwarf warriors. The wyvern with Azag is going in trying to get at the gyrocopters. Taking a bit of damage is Azag, but I'm feeling relatively safe at this point. And the trolls have been able to do some damage. The orc boar boy biggins are going in. And there we have it, the gyrocopter is breaking. Sending in my black orcs now. The black orcs. You'll notice that killing happens a lot slower in this game than what we've been used to previously. Certainly seems that way with damage being scaled down and engagements being more reliant on morale, really. See, the trolls are getting chopped down here a bit by the longbeards. These are two troll units fighting a longbeard unit. So over here you see the morale problems with just the orc boys. However, the black orcs are still in the fight and doing better than ever. But many of these units are going to come back. So just using Azag here to get some of these miners and quarrelers off the field. They were shooting at my trolls, which I don't want. A bit of friendly fire there. Focusing fire with my goblin archers. It's quite astounding how much fire these dwarves can take. But then goblin archers are shitty. So this is a very chaotic battle. This isn't the reason why I wanted to show you this battle, dwarves, because this army isn't a very typical greenskin army. It's a greenskin army that I picked to be fun. Not just whoa. Yeah, that's what I meant. So the Slayer King chasing after some goblin archers here, and he gets into it and starts killing. And the black orcs, just about the only orcs that haven't been defeated by dwarves yet, winning against longbeards and dwarf warriors. Azag is starting to look a bit tattered. Landing on the longbeards. Need to be careful here. That would be the steam cannon on the gyrocopter. I really hope I am firing. Yeah, now I'm firing on the gyrocopter. These goblins were not paying attention. So now the gyrocopter is taking damage. It does have 100 armor, but all of these arrows are doing AP damage and eventually picking apart the health of the gyrocopter. And there the gyrocopter is going down. So an annoying gyrocopter off the field there. So at this point I basically only have my doom diver. I have my goblin archers, I have my general, which is of course very important. The dwarven master engineer died a long time ago to a spirit leech or doom diver or a combination thereof. So what's happened here is that the dwarves have broken through my center. My center is completely gone. However, on the flanks, my black orcs have held. And they are winning on the flanks. So 100 kills here for the black orcs, which is quite good against dwarf warriors and longbeards. And now comes the late game where I can use magic and fear to my advantage, hopefully. So Obelix is being smart and trying to chase away my trolls here. Which probably is going to work for him, because trolls are stupid creatures. Finally managed to win here, and this is so important. The trolls coming back. So just want to get them into an engagement as soon as possible before they decide to run off the field again. So there we are. Getting some killing done here against the miners with blasting charges. Winning slightly and wavering due to damage sustained. The leadership, you can see the leadership ticking down there, going into the miners, and the trolls are now routing. They will not come back from that. But they did get some additional kills, at least. Not even fighting back the stupid creatures. So at this point, pouring the fire in. And you've seen how much my goblin archers have been firing, and they haven't killed shit yet. They are firing on dwarves, but still. Asag has taken a fair bit of damage. Mostly my goblins are just running away from whatever Obelix is, from whatever Obelix has left. The black orcs chasing down dwarves, and notice how many black orcs I have left. That one 110 armor is exceptionally useful and makes them have much needed survivability in the orc army. So that is one thing you don't have too much of. You do have a lot of stuff, but you don't have that much survivability. So exhausted black orcs charging into the longbeards. Still they are racking up the kills. Now it doesn't look too good for the dwarves here, charging in with Asag and trying to break the longbeards. And there we are, the longbeards are, and when the longbeards are breaking, it's about to be over. But no, here the Slayer King, with his 120 armor, is being fired upon a lot by my arrows. And he just doesn't care. So I'm sending in orcs. He's buffing his abilities, or he's buffing his combat abilities. Deadly Onslaught, Foe Seeker, Stand Your Ground. And he's going to slaughter these orc boys, no problem at all. So the boys are just going to have to die, and I'm going to have to wait until my black orcs get there with their armor penetrating weapons to be able to kill the Slayer King. And at this point, I didn't have any magic left. So I just decided to land here, do a bit of friendly fire. And he is barely losing health, the Slayer King. But he is going to fall under the tide of black orcs. I'm not giving anything away there. There's just no way he's going to come back from this. Black orcs, Asag. Pyrrhic victory there for the orcs against the dwarves. And I like that battle. It was a long ass battle. First time I've seen a normal infantry unit get over 200 kills here. So both black orcs did well. If they were in the center, I don't think they would have done that well. They would have gotten a face full of blasting charges and corner stuff. Trolls also did a decent enough job. Might not expect them to do too well against dwarves in just a head-on engagement, but if you attack depleted units, they can do a reasonable job. So what you're getting with the greenskins, you're not getting the most powerful army out there, but you're getting an army that can hold its own. And just to illustrate that point, if you want to go with the melee route as the greenskins, several ways you can go about that. bringing in some orc boys, bringing in some orc biggins, a few goblin wolf riders, and I'm my mind isn't made up about trolls yet. I like them for the fear effect, but they are not very reliable. So you can bring full-on melee rushes like this, or something a bit more like what I showed you in the battle, or you can just go full Fontard and create an army that in no way resembles an army, that is just an odd assortment of units that have no chance of winning a battle, but that will at least give you something colorful and fun to look at while you are controlling your Doomdiver catapults in first person mode. So Greenskins, one of my favorite factions, not necessarily in this game, but just the whole Greenskin war thing. So when I've played the most with the Greenskins, I think, and when I've gotten a good enough grip on the other factions, I'm going to be making a video about them as well. Any questions, ask away. Strike the order.